Welcome back to STS. In today's tutorial, we're going to continue working with inverse functions. All right, let's begin by working with a cubic function. All right, here I'm just drawing in my xy plane, and let's just kind of freehand a cubic function. We know a cubic is going to look something like so. To verify that any function is in fact 1-to-1, which means that we can actually derive an inverse, we use the horizontal line test. And the horizontal line test just says I can draw horizontal lines for the life of this function, and those horizontal lines will only intersect this function at one location. So here we see that this cubic is in fact 1-to-1. So let's take a look at an example. Let's say we have f of x is equal to the quantity x plus 4, where that entire quantity is taken to the third power. First thing we have to do is, if we're in f of x notation, that must be converted to a y. So here I have y is equal to the quantity x plus 4 taken to the third power. Second thing we have to do is to go ahead and swap those x's and y's. So this y becomes an x, and this x becomes a y, leaving everything else in place. The third thing we need to do is to go ahead and solve for y. So in doing so, we see that I've got something to the third power on the right hand side, and that's where the y is involved. On the left hand side, it's just an x. So to undo that third power, I need to take the cubed root of both sides. So I'm going to take the cubed root of x, and I take the cubed root of this entire quantity on the right. Taking the cube root of this quantity, which is taken to the third power, that leaves me with just the y plus 4, which is the quantity that was taken to the third power. And on the left-hand side, I'm left with the cube root of x. Now, to solve for y, I subtract 4 from both sides. These 4s cancel, leaving me with the cube root of x minus 4 is equal to y. And now, to put this in the put this in inverse notation, I've got the cube root of x minus 4. So that there is the inverse of this original function that we started with up here. Now let's go ahead and call up the calculator and see how we can verify this visually. If you'll notice, I've gone ahead and already put in the original equation, y plus 4. The quantity y plus 4 raised to the third power, and then the inverse, which is the cube root of x minus 4. And notice in this first location, I put in the equation y equals x. Y equals x is our line of symmetry, and when you have a function and its inverse, those two functions should be or have to be symmetric with respect to that line y equals x. As some would say, it has to be symmetrical with respect to the origin. So let's notice our colors. The blue is the line of symmetry, the red is the original function, and the black is going to be the inverse. So let's go ahead and graph. Here we have the blue coming in as our original function, coming in as our line of symmetry, the red coming in as the original function, and then we have the black, which should be up here momentarily, which is going to be the inverse. Notice how it doesn't actually look symmetrical here on the calculator. It looks close to being symmetrical, but not quite. We need to change the zoom. So let's click on zoom, and if you look at option 5, that's z squared. So it's going to make this the x and y axis the same or square in relation to each other. So we have perfect. So now we can have a perfect symmetry. So again, there's our line of symmetry. The red is our original equation, and here we see the black should be coming in any moment, and the black here is the inverse, and as we look at this, we see that they are in fact symmetrical. Let's look at one more thing here with the calculator. So let's go to second quit. We know that the first equation was in position 2. Let me go back to y equals. Let me clear this out. The original equation is in y sub 2, And we see that the inverse here is in y sub 3. We're going to use that to leverage a test here. So we press alpha, and then we press F4. And we're going to press the number 2 to get to our second y sub 2, which is the original equation. And let's give it an input of, let's say, 8. And then we press enter, and we see that when 8 is input, the output is 1,728. Now let's take a look at the inverse, which is going to be in position 3, or y sub 3. And we know that if it's an inverse, if I take the output of the original function and make that the input of the inverse's output should match the input of the original equation. I know that's a mouthful, but the short way of saying it is that the domain and range values are switched for the inverse function. So here, when I evaluate this inverse with the input of 1,728, the output should be 8. And here we see that is true. Let's just do one more test. Let's go again with the original function. Now let's say the input is 1.25. We see the output comes out to be 144 and 7/10, and a little bit more than 7/10. Let's go to the inverse, which we know is in position 3. We're going to make its input the same as this output here. So I arrow up, press enter to bring that value down, close up the parentheses, and press enter, and we see that does in fact come out to be 1 25/100. Alright, so that sums it up for this video by Speller Tutorial Services. Please friend us on Facebook and also subscribe to our YouTube channel. And as always, thank you for watching.